Good morning. The opening of the reuse committee meeting, the subcommittee of the Northampton Public Works Commission. Today is September 17th. Call the meeting to order. And the first thing is to approve the minutes of August 13th. Has everyone had a chance to peruse them? All right. Any comments, changes? Peter?
Simon's Auction, middle line, account is man purchased, yeah, me purchased.
Read that note, just me purchased. Man purchased.
Okay.
Duly noted.
Anybody else? No? Shaking heads. Then do I have a motion to approve the amended minutes? Peter's comment.
Yes.
Second, okay. Anybody have a problem with that? All right. Sounds like consensus today. The bag ban update. Susan, is that you?
Yeah, sure. So I met with the mayor and Lynn Simmons about the bag ban. If I communicated your message to them, they accepted that, and nevertheless, we need to move forward. So I just wanted to give you an update. There is a woman named Jody Young who's had experience in marketing and has some design experience as well. And she had volunteered. She's actually a friend, somehow knows Jessica Hanner. And she volunteered her services to help out with the bag ban as far as getting some marketing material out there and stuff. She's seen some things happen out west when she lived out west, and she offered her services. So we met, and I brought these just to kind of show you that she's creative, and I'm looking forward to what we come up with. These are not at this point what we're going to work with necessarily, but I wanted to show them to you. We talked about having a brand thing, as Diana has often spoken about, having something that's instantly recognizable as being the bag ban symbol.
I've talked about that as being the reuse committee.
Just the whole concept of branding.
Okay.
Yeah, and Diana has taught us about the concept of branding, so you want something recognizable and you want to use it often so that people get to know what it is, like the Target symbol. Target. So this was something that she came up with first. We're not going to go with this, but this was something that she came up with, and she people's initial reaction was that it was cutesy, and she argues that so somebody had suggested that perhaps we put the seal of Northampton on it or something like that. And the thing with a brand is that it needs to be very simple. It needs to be easy to recognize and not complicated and fussy. And it needs to evoke a certain feeling. And so there's something about the seal that evokes a lot of regimented kind of bureaucracy that isn't what we want with this. And so she said, you want to make it fun and appealing. And so the people felt the heart was a little too cutesy, whatever. I mean, she says she feels strongly that it has to be fun in some respect. It has to grab their attention and pull them in. And so it doesn't have to be a heart, but cutesy can be okay with a brand. And we're working with this. The mayor found something that he liked from the West Hollywood back then thing. So we're gonna kind of go towards that ilk. If you want to Google it, I have a picture of it somewhere. But anyway, so this was the very first blush. It took her about 5 minutes to do. She was pretty, you know. And then these are two other things that she had come up with for potential kind of posters. And again, these were the very first blush. And we talked about when she and I met that we want it to be a really positive campaign and not we have a bag ban, you need to comply, but more promoting the positive behaviors that we want to promote. So that's kind of where we went with this. And people had various comments about this being a little too kid-like or whatever, but we're trying to make something that's fresh and powerful and trying to please an audience of people who all have different ideas. So we don't have a lot of time, so I'm hoping that the next couple trials are going to be something that will make a lot of people happy. So we are meeting with the mayor hopefully next week again, she and I, and we hope to move it forward. So as far as getting word out, there's going to be a letter that's going to go out to the business community that uses bags about the ban. We have a website we're developing, and after the letter goes out to the business community, there's going to be more of a public awareness campaign. We've talked about point of sale tent cards that people can put at their registers. I've tried to get a hold of the Chamber of Commerce people and try to get some of their input. I have not yet heard from Paul Spector and Jesse Adams. It would be helpful to know what kind of statistical information that they gathered about bags and stuff like that, so that that can help us with our educational campaign. So that's where we are with that. And if anyone is interested in helping as a side thing with some of the things that need to happen, please let me know offline.
What bags are banned?
The bags that are banned are single-use plastic bags that are less than 3 mils thick. And I have some samples of bags. I wish I could give him, could remember his name. The fellow from Mansfield Paper has been very helpful. We order our smart bags from him, and he sent some samples. Part of the challenge is going to be getting the health department people to the point where they can identify different mils of bags. A mil has been explained to me as the thickness of one layer of paint, essentially. So 3 mils
really
is, yeah. Well, 3 mils is, I mean, so I think our blue bags are 2 mils, something like that.
Oh, trash bag?
Yeah, they have to be pretty thick. They need to be pretty
they
thick.
They do, always.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So, I mean, the whole point is they need to be reusable, and at 3 mils, they're thick enough and durable enough that you can reuse them. So, what has happened? I don't know if you, how much you've been watching this, or how many of you were at the public hearing. But what's happened in some other communities that have banned bags is that they say this is probably, I don't know, maybe 1 or 0.5 mil.
No, it's under that. Well, drop cloth soap, about one. You know, very cheap one.
But it's not thick enough.
No. This isn't thick enough. So, this one is banned, yes. So, what was I saying? I was saying something, I was going somewhere.
Measurement.
How to
measure
thickness.
How to
identify
it.
It's biggest.
Yeah, right. Well, so we're going to have to be able to. Unfortunately, the other thing is that they don't usually say the mil on the invoice, and they don't usually say the mil on the box. Whether that's something that has developed because of bag bans or not, I don't know. But the I know what I was going to say. Some communities have announced that they need to be like greater than 1 mil or greater than 2 mil, and the plastic industry has circumvented those bans by producing a bag that's just a hair over the millimeter thickness. So
just a hair over 3.
No. In other communities, they haven't done 3. They've had lower than 3 in their legislation, and so the plastic industry has come up with a bag that meets their requirement, but only just. And so people were able to explain to Councilors Adams and Spector that this had happened, so they were able to change it before it was passed to up the mill things. But I don't want to belabor this.
And you were saying there were at least 2 exceptions, the bag that newspapers commit and the bag used for produce.
Right, yeah. These are shopping bags that you carry your material, you know, shopping.
I think it would be helpful if we could get some 3-millimeter bags. Because I think there's a massive difference.
Right. Right, right, yeah, yeah.
We just don't know what 3 mils is.
Yeah.
I haven't seen them sit on the floor.
Oh, you've seen them.
Learning about.
Yeah, sometimes they're really, you've seen them. Sometimes somebody will give you a really thick plastic shopping bag. It's one of those really thick ones.
If you buy garbage bags, those are usually listed with how thick they are because they want you to buy the thicker ones, so like the contractor bags, so the green or the black, or they usually are, and those are 3 millimeters.
Right. They are more expensive when they're thicker, so the whole point is not to proliferate plastic bags, but to get people to start reusing bags, which is why we kind of have gone down the we're going to bring our own bags as of January 1st kind of thing. And there's also a lot of other communities who've done this, so we can show examples of other communities and how it's worked. And Ireland, for instance, everyone brings their own bag now in Ireland. There's lots of really good examples to point to.
So these thicker bags, plastic bags that are being allowed, is there any effort to put a little note on them that says this bag can be reused? Rather than just because it's thicker, we're going to throw it out.
Right. That would be very difficult to administer and legislate. It's an excellent idea, but that should be built into the public education campaign if at all possible.
But it could be an incentive for any business to use it, basically, to show that you read it.
Similar to the recycling tags.
I think it's a very good idea.
Have a little number on the bag that looks like recycling number, but it's different.
Yeah.
It's a thickness tag.
Yeah. But administering, putting those on the individual bags would be difficult, but putting them into our campaign, or the campaign of the bag information would be really
Yep.
Do you want comments about the branding?
Offline, I think I'm a little worried about timing because we've got some other things that people are going to be passionate about.
Okay.
So I'd be happy to hear what you have to say offline.
All right. Anything else about the bag then, Susan? All right. Intern update. Is that yours also?
Intern update, yes. Anna has flown the coop and is now back at Oberlin. I have a card going around. If everyone could sign the card for her, that would be great. I will mail it to her with something that denotes our affection, whether it's cookies or something, I don't know.
Well, we have those bags that Gabby printed up too with the
A bag full of snacks.
She did a really great job, and I wanted to show y'all what her crowning glory is. And she has put this into a form that should be accessible online. I need to meet with Frank Forbes. I'm having some computer issues that are taking taking priority because my laptop computer is very old and it's really, really slow. And so I have to get IT's help with that before I can start messing with this online. But I have two copies here. One is sorted by the organization or the this is her Who Takes What database. I asked her to put it in Excel so that it was a form that was easily sortable and easily importable into various other computer programs. So she has a list of the place, whether it's reuse or recycling. She has it categorized. She collected websites, addresses, towns, phone numbers, and various other notes. So I have one sorted by A to Z, the item, what types of items, and I have one sorted by the organization. So for instance, DPW costume swap, is one, or Best Buy is another. Although Best Buy, I hear, is filing for bankruptcy, which is very sad for me, but I don't know whether it's Chapter 11 or Chapter 13, but
I heard it was just sadly not holding.
They're closing.
Right.
They're closing?
The head next door, not the whole.
I didn't hear they were fine.
They're shrinking, I think.
Okay, they're just closing the store. Okay, I'm sorry to spread rumors. I take that back.
Change the name to Better Possible.
Well, they, you know what? They were one of the first big national chains to have some not producer responsibility, but to take some responsibility for the stuff that they're generating. And it was, my heart goes out. My heart, you know, I'm very loyal to them as a result.
Rob?
I wanted to say that there was a initial draft of that I have used at the Reese Center. I think it's great because it's a wonderful thing to give people that come in and like, I'm sorry, we can't really take child carriers, but you can go to, you know, looking at it and saying you can go to this place for it. So it's a wonderful resource to have to tell people about. So
And where is it available, Susan?
It's going to be available online.
But it was also on that desk before it got reorganized, it's in the office now.
I think everybody that's working out there should have a hard copy of it.
Yeah, exactly.
We have a sheet on the clipboard that has some of that information. I think she's gone more in depth and gotten better.
And you could have it home too, you know, because people are always asking you stuff.
Batteries.
I would love for it to be online as soon as possible if there's any way to help you with that.
Okay, well, it's a matter of working with IT.
Right. And that can't be done by anybody else, is that?
It's hard because you don't have the clearances to use the website and stuff like that.
Well, knowing that this could be a time problem because we're working with IT, is there any way to get a hard copy of this to everyone?
Oh, absolutely. I can
email it, PDF.
Yeah, that's fine.
That'd be great. I get questions a lot from people that I'm like, I think that's in the process.
Right.
Yes, I'll get back to you on that.
Debbie?
Can we put that on the Facebook page?
No, you can't. It would have to be in a document form. This is not an easy document. I mean, and even that, the Facebook page is kind of ephemeris. It's not something like you can store information necessarily. It's more kind of what's happening now.
Yes.
It's just a different medium. Email and a job large. So, but that's it. I will email a copy to you, and it is. I've made space for it on the website, and we can make it more prominent. We can do a press release about it once it's up and running.
Great.
She did a great job. I sent in her official evaluation and raved. So.
All right, recenter update. Who's taking that?
You want to go talk about that?
The event is next, so I'll take that. I think things have been going well at the recenter.
Last Saturday morning, we had an extremely busy morning to the point where I think we really needed two people most of the time doing intake and outgoing. So it just keeps... From my point of view, it keeps ramping up. I guess since the last meeting, we did have the Salvation Army come and take a bunch of stuff, which was helpful because we were bursting at the seams, basically. I've been going out there regularly on Wednesdays. We've been having conversations about opening Wednesdays. At this point, my feeling is we probably need, in order to say to the public that we're going to be open every Wednesday, we have to have the public, and we have to have the staff to back it up. I'm willing to go there most Wednesdays, but not every Wednesday, so I kind of feel like if another supervisor emerges that would share that with me to some extent, then that becomes more viable. But at this point, I feel like we don't really need to go there right away. I still do accept things unofficially, but I always tell people we're not officially open and don't count on it because you might come out here on a given Wednesday and nobody would be here. So I think it's okay to kind of continue with that status until somebody else says, hey, I'd like to do this.
But people have not been taking things, they've just been donating things.
People have been donating things, yeah. And if it's their first time out there, I invite them to come in and look around. You know, know, that it just doesn't happen very often. But Wednesdays are really essential, I feel, in terms of rebooting the space after a busy Saturday because of the way we get a lot of stuff crammed in there at the end of the Saturday. So that's the Wednesday thing.
Can I interject? I would recommend that we hold off talking about opening Wednesdays until next year. We only have about six more weeks.
Just in terms of public information, it just doesn't make sense to change it right now.
This is somewhat related to now, but also the future. I mean, Ro had sent an email around talking about the budget, you know, and how much of our budget we've used up with the money that the DPW awarded us. And it appears that there's a substantial amount of money left in there. And Diane and I were talking a little bit the other day about starting a conversation about how we could use that money in terms of fixing up the annex or getting something coming off the side, the right side, an awning coming off, or other infrastructure investments, rather than see that money just evaporate at some point. So I don't know if we want to talk about that now or.
Yeah, what were the parameters put around that money? I thought it was for the construction phase. I don't know that there were any limits at all. Okay.
At the time, the board's commitment was, before we turn into a commission, let's try to make sure we get a recenter started and allocate some funding for that. Uh-huh. So initially, I don't recall, David, you may have other thoughts, that there were any parameters put on it except within the DPW guidelines or the city guidelines. I mean, we can't go out to dinner or buy backpacks or anything like that. But the point is that we wanted to take some money from the solid waste enterprise fund while it had some excess after the landfill closed and allocated to the reuse center per the solid waste reuse commission and per the fact that we needed. And
I think fundamentally what would be great to have out there is a repair to the roof so that the annex didn't leak water into the space where we're storing things. Better lighting and the line painting are the three, awning off of the side that we can put things under a little bit of shelter that don't need a lot of shelter, but off to that grassy side.
Every time I see Ned face to face,
line painting.
the line painting is going to happen. I don't know why it hasn't happened thus far, but
well, the problem is that it can only happen in the summer. Even if it now it's like toward the end of the season, and maybe it will be preserved until next spring, but. My concern is like, oh, it's so late now. Will it last through the winter? So, because we don't have cars driving over it during the winter, so it might be just fine. I mean, better late than never.
Right.
Roger?
I was thinking that probably one a good way to spend a decent amount of money was to fix up the area where all the wooden stuff is stored, so you don't have to. They don't have to be accompanied.
That's the annex.
So you can just walk in there. So you don't have to be accompanied.
Right. Right.
And that gives us a lot of, once that's done, we can actually start moving stuff into that area.
Right.
Well, if it
gives us expansion space.
I think that's a great idea because spaces are premium.
Yeah.
You do not have enough space for what the demand is. And so
roofing space is really.
Yeah, and as a supervisor, I've been turning away some bigger items because we just can't fit them in the other space. And when we get large furniture, it tends to stay there for quite a while because people don't come out really with a vehicle that can take it away and that sort of thing. I think it's good to have some big furniture around, but it clogs up the other
space. Well, that's also bulletin board,
I got rid of the bunk bed that was out there all summer, basically. Uh-huh. Not the bulletin board, but the neighborhood listserv. Uh-huh. But we need capacity because we never know. Somebody pulls in a pickup truck and they have a really nice big thing.
Right, yeah.
And we got to have a place to put it right now
right.
if we want to take it.
Right,
and
right.
you know, if we, with the annex, we could put wooden pallets on the floor all over and then put that kind of stuff up so it's not on the ground. And if it has a roof that's good over it, it's good in there.
Well, why don't we continue this discussion during the working group meeting and make, figure out what we propose, you know, that we would like to ask for money to do, and then we'll bring it next month or get the approval or, you know, we'll take the channel back.
Well.
Then also, another thing is that the working group, the Tuesday morning meeting has talked a lot about some changes for next year. So if anybody has ideas for that, but we're going to wait and follow your recommendation or whoever was talking about it. We're talking about changes for next year after we close this year. But so there might be a lot of changes. I'm not talking major changes, I'm just saying general process of how we do things. So if you have ideas, be sure, and you're not able to come to the working group meetings, pass it on.
We'd also like to suggest that we somehow, before the year's over, plan some way to thank some of the volunteers who are not on this committee to come out to the New York Center on the weekends. They've been very helpful, Stanley, quite a few.
Right.
There's other people who really donate a lot of their time and been very helpful. I'd like for us to acknowledge them.
So my business has an unlimited supply of pallets. So I can always bring them out to the recenter. Anything?
I need some pallets. Right to here.
Just come to my warehouse, Peter.
Okay, got it.
Ro.
I can't come to the recenter meeting is going to be next Tuesday or next week.
We're trying to figure out if it's Tuesday or Wednesday.
It's not clear. Well, because people had said that maybe it'd be good to meet out at the recenter. So it will either be next Tuesday or next Wednesday.
Okay. So I can't be there at all next week, but I just wanted to pass on a new issue that has come up, and it came up last week, which is that two different instances of people coming through with dogs, that we can't have animals in there. It's just too small of an area. And so if you could discuss that at the meeting, it was just, it's not that there's anything wrong with people or with the dogs, it's just, it's too small, and I just,
throw that out.
Because we have that's a rule out at the transfer station in Amherst. The dogs have to stay in the car.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Could we have a sign
for
that?
Mm-hmm.
Would that help?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You could also tell them. Mm-hmm. Gatekeepers.
Peter.
Just before the roof gets left aside, it's much easier to fix it while the weather is still warm and having been up there, it really needs the screws replacing the nails. Where they've popped, I assume long enough screws, you can get that down. And then you use zinc or aluminum, it's a paint, use it for campers. And that seals up over the rust and everything. So, and it needs warm weather. So if somebody still had screws of done, I assume, right, they would fix there. And it's not expensive, I mean, for that section.
Okay.
It cost a whole lot of money.
Nice pan.
That's a beautiful. Yeah. Those are really good.
By the way,
the artist is in the house.
Yeah.
If anybody wants one, they didn't get one.
So before we move on, the last thing that we need to talk about is Peter has been promoting the concept of repair at Smith Folk and trying to get some kind of a collaboration with the Smith Folk people for lamp repair, etc. And so before he's met with the principal and spoken with the electronics.
No, I met with the principal.
Yeah, so I just, because this is related to our enterprise here, I wanted to make sure you guys were all aware of what he was doing and that he was operating under the reuse committee's, you know, auspices, as opposed to his own, which, you know, so I just wanted to make sure everyone understood what he was doing and we were all on board with it so he can represent us and not just himself.
Well, I'm happy to answer any questions, but basically it's getting, right now, the electrical program head to buy into this, which I haven't heard back.
Buy into what?
A repair program going similar to the appliance repair, you know, same structure, maybe the appliance repair program that they used to have.
And it would be only lamp repair?
I think to start with, one of the Gifford, the curriculum person, said it could be worked into the curriculum because it wouldn't be a separate after-school operation, which they say students all just take off because they come from the whole valley and it's very hard to do in after school. But if it can be built in as a hands-on practicum, whatever you call it, as part of the curriculum. So that's what I'm hoping.
So what's our affiliate, what's this group's affiliation with that program?
What are you trying to set up, Peter? That's the question.
Yeah. So that we can help supply from the recenter.
Things that need to be repaired.
Or actually, the follow-up email was, once they've learned the safe way to repair things, that allows another program, which is the lamp making, because I'm suggesting a sale. You know, once a month they can have a sale of repaired lamps that we've given them.
At our facility?
No, I think that'd be at Smith.
Okay. I'm just trying to figure out what you're proposing this group is doing with, where does the overlap?
Trying to turn Smith Folk into a client, one of our clients. With an active community participation, because if we can like have the lamp repair program with maybe the November thing, because the other two with the tag sale, it would compete and with the customer would compete. But so that in November, if we had that workshop, which I hope would attract Smith Folk students, I don't know how it's going to go. You know, it depends on. The three people I talked to, the superintendent, principal, and the curriculum director, all were enthused. You know, it's just now getting them to.
Peter, is there anything you need from this committee?
And you find anybody who goes to Smith Folk, including the who graduated from Smith Folk, is the daughter of the fellow Scott Fanouf, who is going to do the electrical repair workshop.
For us. So there are two pieces here. Yeah. There's the stuff that Peter's promoting at Smith Folk for a curriculum change to encourage more repair in the curriculum. And then there is the potential repair workshop that he has identified somebody who would be willing to lead at the recenter or somewhere else.
Yeah, that's what last Saturday. It would be hard to have a really serious repair when you're worried about rain and wind and sun
and tools. And
so this would be something that the committee would organize and it would take place at Smith Folk. It would be for the public?
Yes. I've noticed that we, although it changed last time because Tom made the entrance from the side to the bathrooms, but originally we were having an empty space to walk through to the back, which is the cafeteria. And that could be a workshop room, for instance, or another classroom along the way. Whatever we can arrange, I don't think it would cost us much of any money because it would be a part.
And they would be willing to have this fellow or his daughter teach it?
I haven't got that far. The fellow is.
Okay, Roger.
Well, it also concerns us because if we're going to start taking things that aren't working, we need to know what things they're willing to take to repair. Mm-hmm. So if we can take a lamp that's not working, then fine, put it over here. Right. And I rolled the space that we're saving for Smith Folk.
It's nothing, I don't think it's anything that we would do this year yet.
No, but I'm just saying that's the intersection of us. Right. So if they're going to start looking at TV panels, over here, whatever they tell us they're going to have a workshop for the kids, it's not working. Usually we would say, no, you have to recycle it. Now we can hopefully take more stuff out of the waste stream.
Rob?
Both Susan and Roger sort of addressed my concern, which is this is for something we should talk about for later, and we need to keep our focus on lamp, you know, preventing stuff from going into the landfill. So we don't want to get too diverse in our goals with respect to Peter, and I think it's a great concept. I just think we want to keep our focus on it.
Peter, our visionary Peter is really good at planting seeds. So
yes.
He's planting seeds
and
at Smith Folk, and so you know, with some promotion and some watering and feeding, hopefully something.
Yes.
And we have a road to help.
Thank you, Peter.
But it's very consistent with the goals of this committee.
Right.
Oh, it's perfect.
That sounds like a great winter activity when the Reese Center's closed.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like an intrusion or extrusion into the repair.
Well, I got a soft spot for Smith because it's hands-on stuff.
Yeah.
You know, they're learning to use their hands. Mm-hmm. And most people, other than a screen, you know.
Well, having them teach, not just the teachers, but the students can start teaching people in the community how to do this. That's great.
Yeah. Anybody else on the subject of Smith Folk and repair instruction? All right. Event updates. September 12th, wrap.
We had that event on Saturday. I think it went really well. A lot of participation, a lot of great volunteers. Thank you, everybody, who showed up.
Great snacks.
Thank you, David. Fantastic.
I took the snacks away from the Reese Center because I was afraid of mice. Yeah. But there are some in the cabinet in the office, and I will bring more. They're at my house. I'll bring them back. I've eaten a few.
David, that was a really, really nice touch.
Yes, thank you.
People like it.
It's great.
And it raised a lot of money, too, because people said, is this free? And I said, sure, uh-huh. But we'll also take a donation.
Uh-huh. We had $33 donated.
Maybe we should do that every Saturday.
We've
always got stuff to bring, so when you run out, let me know.
Okay. All right, thank you.
And I think Roger deserves special recognition for the music.
Yes.
And it was wonderful.
That was great.
Thank you. Yeah, and the people I asked to come and display things did, and it was really nice. I think it went well. It was really busy. It was a lot. Because the morning was so busy, and then it went on until 3, and felt really
Did a lot of people show up especially for the noon to 3 part of it?
There was another surge, yeah, after noon. It was a little bit lighter public traffic than I'd hoped, but it was good. People were really enthusiastic when they
the
came.
The traffic was a little disappointing. Mm-hmm. I felt reminiscent of the art show and sale, because even though we didn't have paid advertising, I really heavily promoted on Facebook. We sent it out to listservs. There was an article in the paper. There was, you know, Max. It was listed in the paper. It was Max thing. There was a lot of stuff going on last weekend.
It was a very busy weekend.
So yeah, I think that was a big piece. And I also want to say that promotion that we did might have been why we were so busy on Saturday morning. Mm-hmm. Because we really heavily, when I put it on Facebook and I promoted it, I paid to promote it on Facebook. And when that happens, it goes to people who have liked our page and their friends. So in the Northampton area, I targeted it toward the Northampton area. So it's possible that we just put ourselves out there and people said, oh, I'd like to go there that morning, you know. So it'll be interesting to see how it is this weekend. Mm-hmm.
I got a little feedback from Marcia that people were coming to her before noon and saying, I don't have to have a sticker. And she was like, well, actually, after noon, you have to.
I made her a sign, but I didn't get there till 11. Uh-huh. So I had a sign, but so next time. And we did put signs out on the road, which, uh-huh. Lessons learned. I used cardboard to reuse, but black ink on cardboard is not necessarily stand out. So we need to do white something on cardboard.
Rob?
I wanted to thank Max for the article in the paper. I do think it was.
Matt, that was fantastic.
Did everyone see that?
Yeah. I'm sharing it with everybody.
Yeah.
I thought it just stated our mission so well. It was really great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Brought a real new element to it.
There's a copy that can go around, but we can make copies of it, I suppose. There was also a follow-up article. I'm guessing because, judging from the amount of time that he spent speaking to people and the way that this doesn't flow as well as you would think it would, I think this was a longer article that got chopped. And so, but it's nice nevertheless, and it was nice to get some recognition. I wasn't thrilled with the title because it says, meant to inspire public. Like we didn't achieve that? Yes, we achieved it!
Right.
So I need to talk to their editorial staff that writes their headlines.
But my comment was I felt sort of badly, but I understand the dilemma that you know, the event that we had in the afternoon wasn't as well attended as I was hoping it would be. It's a long way to go, and it's the afternoon when there's a gazillion everything going on. And it would have been nice if we could have done it in the morning, but at the same time, we were sloppy in the morning. There was traffic problems, there were so many cars, and there's so much stuff. I don't know how we could have done it in the morning, but it was a dilemma.
Yeah. We have real limitations in terms of space and what we could fit there.
Well, you know, one possibility, again, might be to do it as a winter event at Smith Oak, you know, where there's a lot more parking, and where we could, and could conceivably combine it with another event.
Uh-huh. Right.
Part of the point of the event this time was to get people to the recenter let people know more about it. But maybe we could promote it at Smith Oak
I mean, at this point, I'm just not too worried about getting people out to the recenter because of what we're seeing.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. I mean, that's what it's like. What have we created here sometimes, you know?
Well, people to take away, we need.
Yeah, that's right.
Anything else about September 12th wrap? The event? Any questions about it? All right. October. Yes, Roger.
I'll just say, you know, I don't know if we're going to do that again, but we probably need more canopies. Right?
Yes. We will have a tent, by the way. I got clearance to order one, and then my credit card, I only have one, was compromised, and there was a problem, and they didn't send it within the 10 days. So it didn't make it in time for the 9/12 event like I wanted, but I will be ordering one now that I finally got my credit card.
Yep. A really soft, sturdy one.
I want to thank Peter for putting up the canopy.
With subsequent review, there's a few things we got to do differently.
But it worked.
Yeah.
It worked.
Yeah. October 10th, tag sale. Peter, that's you, right?
And Roger. We have the possibility, there's 170 spaces as we added them up. So two to a place would give you 85 spaces that we potentially could fill there. We talked about having a separate section for professional dealers, which would be along the football field because they like to sell out of the side. Mm-hmm. We're doing this for the community, but obviously you can't exclude somebody. So like the guy who's doing hats, t-shirts and stuff, he should be over against the fence. Anybody do anything professional. But we have a lot of places we could sell. So if you envision that back parking lot.
I've added a statement to the sign-up form that explicitly says that our intention is to promote the reuse of goods and to help people who have trouble doing it at their homes and don't have other options. And if you fall outside of that intention, you might be placed in a special area. Just so that people understand that.
Mm. The only question is having, Susan was worried about folks like the guy with the t-shirts who sets up at 6:30 maybe or something, mm-hmm. and he's in some place, so how do you stop that? Mm-hmm. So other than tape, caution tape or something the night before.
Right. Yeah, the problem is that he's been coming quite early before I even get there, mm-hmm. so he's all set up and you can't ask mm-hmm. him to move. Takes the prime spot.
Yeah.
So because this is intended for a different audience, we want to prevent that if we can. Mm-hmm. Because I'm not about to ask him to move when he's all set up. So we ask people to get there no earlier than a certain time, and just like early birds at garage sales, you can't control that. So
any ideas on that?
Can we mark spots the night before?
Mark them?
Mark them to let people know where they're supposed to set up?
Yeah. Makes it really cumbersome. I mean, that means it's in a reservation, and then you got to check the reservations and then just to that space. So having folks as they're there, you know, in a line, and then you send them either to the center section for the boot sale or to one of the outside spaces for the flea market sale.
Is he the only one that shows up super early? I mean, could we contact him and just say,
right.
Don't do that. You know, here's where you're allowed to go over here.
Yeah, in fact, I was saying, you know, I know another dealer from Holyoke, Paul, who he comes sets up next to usually, and
yeah.
Paul
Well, I mean, if there's even three or four people who are likely to do it, yeah. Just contact them ahead of time.
My hope is that I'll be there early enough.
What time do they get there?
Well, I usually try and get there by 7, 7:15 at the latest, and he's already there, maybe.
Well, I was just going to say, if you're clear about not coming before 7 or whatever the time is, I think you can ask him to move. I know you don't want to, but you have to think about the greater good.
Right, you have to see how much stuff
he has. I understand, but, you know.
Yeah, I agree.
Well, so what we'll do this time is call and speak with him directly.
If we can, that's wonderful.
I mean, we have contact information.
Great, so good.
One other thing that I want to say about the tag sale, there are two important things. First of all, when we met, we didn't talk about the costume idea, the costume swap. It was supposed to be a costume swap also. So we need to figure out how and if that costume swap is going to work. I have a press release that's going to go out today about the tag sale only. I asked Corey, who's one of our new volunteers, in an email if she would have any interest in she and her friends helping out with the costume swap portion. We can also ask the high school environmental club or somebody like that to help out, but it needs to happen pretty quickly. If it's going to happen, we need to start getting materials out to the schools and stuff like that. And Diane, I know you've been very busy. I don't know if you're still busy. But I wanted to talk to you about getting the tag sale, some of the tag sale stuff, or at least the costume swap stuff, eventually to meet the criteria that you have put out as far as branding and design and stuff like that. But at the very least, I'd like to update the costume flyer so that can go to the schools.
And I have the file.
You did that. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So would you be willing to help with the costume thing at least? Okay, thank you. So that's one thing, is the costume swap. Are we all in still support of that? And is there anyone here that would be willing to help Peter and Roger with that piece if I don't get a volunteer from someone else? Somewhere else. Could somebody be willing to take that on? Okay, before you answer that, second piece is that we, at last meeting, spoke about collecting materials from the recenter and selling them in our own tag sale space. That's going to need somebody to organize it, and Peter has some concerns about who's going to determine what is sold. Are we going to notify people when they donate it to the recenter that it might be sold, and where are we going to store it, stuff like that. Peter, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, I've been thinking about it some. Pat, what did we write in our, you know, at best? Did we say somewhere that we would be taking stuff out for being sold? Because
I
mean,
I think there is something about that.
Do you?
In our original handbook?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't remember exactly. No.
Well, I think it might be something in the brochure. Does anyone have a copy of the brochure? I think we might have said that we might do something for fundraising.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Oh, we certainly do it for toy swaps.
Yeah. Well, that's the intention.
Right. Yeah. But we haven't sold it, though.
We just
raffled it.
Yeah.
Right. So the toy auction would be a fundraiser. However, it wouldn't be competing with an event where others are coming to sell stuff. I'm just wanting to get some feedback. Is everybody okay that, you know, without having advertised that we're going to sell some of the stuff people have donated, to sort of do it very publicly, competing with people who are, you know, I went home thinking we were going to have a table or tables and we were going to give stuff away. Just didn't connect it to selling. Not, you know, not against it. Just some other. How does that feel in the community?
I don't like the idea of us selling stuff just by donating it. I mean, I think, you know, we're part of the city. I think in some way that we should be promoting free stuff because it's a great way to get people wanting to come to us rather than going down to somebody selling at an antique store or a neighborhood tag sale where they're trying to make money off this stuff. I'm opposed to this. I don't think we need to do it.
Diane, Diane, I knew you were big on the free thing altogether.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I started looking at the flyer. We're talking about having a table at the tag sale
to
and
sell
selling
stuff.
Things. Yeah, I would rather promote the free aspect of the recenter, actually.
So we
things set aside for a raffle or a
silent auction.
Right.
So what happened is last month, we talked about the silent auction, and we decided that instead of having a silent auction, because of the amount of work involved with that, and that we're not prepared to do that, that it would be, that this group thought that having a booth at the tag sale instead and just selling stuff would replace the silent auction as a fundraiser. So that it's fine, whatever the group decides is fine, but I just wanted to explain that it was in lieu of the silent auction. Now, Peter's also talking about having an auction at the toy swap, or toy exchange.
Mm-hmm.
And so the question is, if we don't feel comfortable asking for money for stuff, does that shut down the toy auction concept? And B, what kinds of fundraising sources can we do if we all agree we want to keep stuff free? What kind of fundraising ideas would there be besides this kind of stuff?
That's a lot of stuff to talk about in 3 minutes.
Right.
Yeah. So I was
just on the table then, just on this event. What do we do?
Well,
yeah.
My recommendation would be to have a meeting earlier than normal. The tag sale is on the 10th.
Mm-hmm.
Thursday before the tag sale, I guess, would be the 8th, which is 3 weeks from now. And to talk about these issues, these are not small issues.
No.
And people have very emotional feelings about it, but you know, principled issues about it. So. I think that just try and cram it into the next few minutes is not the right way to go about it.
Well, I don't think that's going to be enough time. If we talk about it on the 8th, I mean, we need to, if we're going to have a tag sale, we need to start collecting stuff now. We could put signs up saying, you know, some things might be selected for a fundraising thing. If it's going to happen for the tag sale, we need to make it happen soon.
We've got plenty of stuff at the recenter if we were going to sell things.
Well, and I was going to say, actually, we have set aside a certain number of things that appear to be valuable, but I don't think there's that many. There's not all that many, so I think if we wanted to just table the idea for now until we can have more of a discussion, that's fine with me. I mean, we have some stuff.
I think it's great to have a table to promote.
Yes.
I mean, I think that's essential.
Absolutely.
Yeah, promote the reason.
But I'm just not totally comfortable with competing with.
Does somebody want to vote and propose a...
Roger?
Well, I was just going to add that having stuff for free is a much stronger competition than selling stuff.
Yeah.
But we can always ask for donations.
Well, we don't have to provide stuff for free at the tax center, but we want to promote...
We could have an informational
thing. Information.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I propose that we put this into the winter decision-making cash and talk about it again, but we don't make any changes at this late stage.
Well, we would have to decide that on the 12th of December.
Well, we don't have to decide that today.
No, we
don't
have to decide
that. But I'm just talking about the 10th.
So is that a motion?
It is a motion.
Okay.
State it again, Rob.
I propose that we defer discussion about whether or not to have the recenter have a table at the tag sale.
To sell.
Until our decision making in the winter time about changes in policies.
Yeah.
Okay.
Second.
Is there a second for that question?
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. Discussion. More discussion about.
Well, that doesn't preclude us having a table. Just promote.
That's right.
That's
right.
That's right.
That's
right. Exactly.
Right. Do we need to vote? Anyone opposed?
There's no more discussions. How do people feel about that? Any objections?
For now. A lot less work.
Okay, great.
Does somebody, so back to my original thing, at the tag sale costume swap, is somebody here willing to help with the organizing of the costume swap on that day? You're shaking your head no.
I mean, I assume that the recenter will be open that day too, so we have to make sure we got staff in there.
Yes.
That's what I was concerned.
Well, I mean, because if I can't find anyone to do it and none of us are willing to do it, I don't want to promote it. I just think we should just drop it.
Yep, agreed.
If it comes together, we could.
We can have it at the recenter too.
Right.
People can bring costumes to the recenter.
Yeah, but the chances of people going out there.
But also on the day of the tag sale, if we put up a sign that says costume swap and have stuff there, could happen. Probably not. Never mind.
But is Corey willing or not?
I haven't heard back from her. I just sent her an email yesterday. So I'm gonna make a few more efforts, but if I don't get a lot of bites, it's not gonna happen.
Okay. November 7th, John?
So I'm gonna be gone from October 3rd to October 20th. So I think looking for volunteers is critical because that was the issue last time. So I'd like to start that process now.
Just remind me how many we need.
Well, we had none last time. You and your son, my wife and I, well, we had Ginny and her husband.
Right.
So we didn't have none. We had a few, but we probably.
So if we could get a half a dozen, that'd be good.
Half a dozen. The environmental club possibly will help at the high school, but I can't.
Can't count on them.
Right.
Okay.
So a call for volunteers would be really helpful.
And the fall event tends to be less busy than the spring event.
Yes.
Tends to be. So it was hard last time.
Well, we are doing styrofoam at the.
Styrofoam, Lucky Ridge Classic, Bikes Not Bombs is coming.
Shredding.
And shredding.
And the paper shredders?
Have you been touching that?
I have not, but I will do that today. And I will talk to the e-cycling people and get those, whatever they call those boxes.
Great.
I'll get that settled.
Excellent.
Do we have a capability for agricultural type plastic? I mean, we do bags and agricultural plastic, I think it's a sort of same thing.
You know what that means?
Huh?
We don't do bags.
The pellet bags.
Oh, we did pellet bags in the spring, we got 10. So we're not going to do it in November because there would be no, I mean, it's the beginning of the season. So
the Gold Circuit didn't take?
No, they took them, we just didn't get.
We didn't get any.
We didn't get any in.
We just didn't.
We did it twice, actually.
Yeah.
We did it.
The year before, we got a bunch.
Yeah.
Last year, this spring, we didn't get any.
Yeah, and maybe that's a lack of awareness. I don't know.
Paper shredding is different.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's not this time.
The what?
It's not this time.
No, I'll get them.
Okay.
Let's come up with a date for the next meeting.
I do have some new business.
Okay, let's come up with a date for the next meeting and we'll have new business.
Okay. It would be the 15th or the 22nd.
Or the 8th if we want to move it forward to have it before the tag sale.
Right.
But is there a reason you would want to have it before the tag sale then?
Because we tabled that discussion.
Good.
I can't make the 22nd.
Is it 15th?
How about the 15th?
Yeah. Good.
All right. We're all okay with it?
New business. Anyone have new business?
I have new business.
Susan.
I mentioned to you before that about the possibility of ReuseConX being in Boston next year. I just wanted you to know it will be in Boston. This is a national conference about reuse called ReuseConX. Marianne Entine, I don't know how to pronounce her name, is the person who is spearheading that. She's been working with the Department of Environmental Protection. And CET is involved, so there's a big push now. It will be either in the summer or fall of 2016, and they're going to have, it's going to be a full-blown convention. So there's going to be tours of various sites around the Boston area. There's going to be, what is it called when all the vendors come, vendor hall, and there's going to be sessions. So it's a really exciting
Is it a multi-day convention?
I think so. You can look up last year, it was in Austin. So you can check it out last year. I think it was 2 or 3 days. So it's called ReuseConX.
Two right? M's, one?
No, just one. Also, Eco Building Bargains has been, Center for Eco Technology has been in touch with me. They have something called Eco Fellows where they are paid positions for college students, graduates, and other people to come and work on them with various things, and largely community-based. I had a nice conversation with him a couple days ago and was talking about what we do, and he was going to bring it back to this group of people, and they're going to figure out how they can get more involved with us. either through their EcoFellow program or something else.
Who's the person at CET?
His name is Ed Rutledge, and he's the one that was in touch with me. So I should be hearing back from him. I told him that there were various things that we could use help with and explained, you know, all the different things that we do. There's going to be, I believe, a webinar with Athena Lee Bradley from NERC, who wrote that article that I sent you. She asked if I wanted to participate in a webinar about reuse efforts here in reuse events in the Western Mass. And I also wanted to just put out there that Recycle America Day is the 15th of November. So at our next meeting, we might want to talk about, do we want to do some kind of a promotional something for that or not? It's a day that largely goes, you know, unmarked, but there's no reason that we couldn't do it if the committee was willing to promote something in particular with a, it doesn't even have to be an event, you know, it doesn't have to be an event, but we could send out a press release about an issue that we want to highlight. We, you know, there's all sorts of different things that we could do. In Amherst, we've put up displays at the library. So we can talk about that next month.
Any other new business? Matt?
A couple of things. One, going back to the toy exchange for a minute, there's the whole question about end users for the toy exchange, because the Salvation Army and the Goodwill are not accepting toys.
Are you 100% sure? Because I don't remember that from our...
The last time they came out for calling, I had a little box of toys, and the guy looked at it and said, no toys.
Wow.
So...
Well, we need to talk to...
Where's Anna's list?
Yeah, we need to, because he did bring up the toy exchange when we were there, Mac, and he did not say we won't come. He did not say we won't take it. So we need to talk to him.
But it could be something that's happened since then.
Jared, yeah.
Put it on people's radar.
Yeah. Well, we have to find another end user is the point.
Either that or we have to consider also maybe charging like a dollar admission or $2 admission and then pay to throw away what's ever left if we don't have an end user.
Right.
Yeah, that's a possibility.
All those stuffed animals.
I was going to...
Or bring it to the recenter.
Actually, we might take those.
Debbie?
Hilltown families. I and Meg and I had a little interchange on email about this, and I said that... we could look at Anna's list about who takes kids' stuff, and also I'd get in touch with Hilltown Families, who seems to be happy center on having kids.
Yeah. Okay.
So they'll.
So Hilltown.
Hilltown Families.
I just had a quick question, and Jessica's Valley Zero Waste newsletter, there was something about DEP giving out grants for mattress recycling. Do you know anything about that?
They have grants that they will give to, it's something new that's coming up. They have been willing to give you money for a container that you can store and transport mattresses in, but only if you take them to a recycling facility. The problem right now, the DEP is promoting mattress recycling, but the problem is there aren't a lot of facilities that handle them. So it's costly to schlep with mattresses to the few that exist. Mm-hmm. So the DEP is working on that. I looked into it in Amherst, and it was prohibitive to send our stuff there. What happens to mattresses now, usually, is they get incinerated, and the metal is reclaimed from the bottom ash. So it's not like, it's not ideal, but it's not like the metal is going into landfills.
It's not as if the mattresses are toxic or anything like that.
They're
full of chemicals.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
So it's not the best solution.
Yeah, yeah.
David?
Do so use something. Process mattresses.
Well, yeah, some places do. In Longmeadow.
I haven't heard. I don't know if they're still doing.
In Longmeadow, they actually have their own person bash them up and pull the metal out and pull the pieces. But that not most communities aren't willing to do that.
Right. More business? More new business?
I don't.
Okay. Should we adjourn? Anyone that wants to stay can stay and talk about Anything else?
Motion.
Motion to adjourn?
So much.
Okay. Thank you.